Motorsport car. Carl was in trouble in qualifying yesterday. This is a very quick lap indeed. Back wow. In the mix.
Up in the ninth position.
South Wales, Australia, Mount Panorama, home to the Bathurst 12 Hour. This is an event where people come to watch the most exotic race cars in the world compete on what is arguably the world's toughest street circuit. At 6.2 kilometres per lap, combined with 23 turns and an elevation of just under 200 metres, it is both grueling and unforgiving. Yet in 2015, with only 2 months to prepare, one Kiwi team decided to take on not only the mountain, but a collection of the world's most established and well-prepared endurance racing teams. However, this story is not about the race itself, but of the Kiwis that dared to dream. Early December 2014, we're in front of friends, racing enthusiasts and the media. Trass Family Motorsport announces their intentions and their goals to take on the best.
Next year, TFM is entering the 458 into the Bathurst 12-hour endurance race. We're the first New Zealand team ever to enter into Class A and the first full Kiwi entry in the Bathurst race. I would now like to announce the Bathurst driver lineup: John O'Lester, Johnny McIntyre and Graham Smythe.
This is one of the most competitive, grueling and world-renowned events on the calendar now. It's the highest profile race I've ever competed in, and for many in the TFM team, I'm sure they can vouch the same. Such is the nature of this event, we've paired with the defending champions in Maranello Motorsport, running as a satellite operation off the side of their team and piggybacking off their infrastructure and their world-class expertise. Whilst on the other side of us in the garage is Ferrari's factory team, AF Corsa.
Being the guy who's been around Bathurst 7 times in a V8, now I finally get to go around in a red one, which is a lot faster than we've ever been. And it'll be my job to help Jono and Graham come along and learn the circuit.
I didn't think I'd ever have the opportunity to drive a Ferrari, let alone at Bathurst. I'm really excited, along with, I'm sure, the rest of the team.
Jumping forward a few weeks, and that team, which was collated from all around the country on very short notice, and who would in fact meet each other for the very first time at the airport, was about to hear some disturbing news. It was highly likely that they would beat the car and the equipment not only to Australia, but to the track itself. So, as is often the way with Kiwis, a she'll be right attitude was taken, and the road trip from Sydney to Bathurst was a good way for everyone to relax. To a point.
Not yet. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Very good, thanks very much. Have a good day.
And once team manager Richard Lester had proven that Kiwis could count to 10, the trip would continue, and a few hours later, for the majority, it would culminate to a view of Mount Panorama for the very first time. And when you don't have a race car to work on or equipment to set up your pits, the next best idea is to see how well a rental van handles the mountain.
Okay.
This is my first time up the mountain, and I can't believe how steep it is. It's incredible. The run up there is miles more than I thought, and it's exactly what I've been told by people who have visited this place. And we're just up the top now, overlooking the view here, and it's just crazy how far we've come to Pitt Lane. It's just, it's quite a daunting place. It's quite amazing to think what we're about to go and do, really.
But what they would do for the rest of the day was to continue the track analysis as best as rookies could, work out where the hard parts are and where grief had been seen on television over so many years. And of course, it allowed them time to get more comfortable with the surroundings and become one with the track. However, nature watching was not the reason for being on the mountain, and the initial track inspection would continue on, with realisation starting to set in.
Into that wall is a judgment, isn't it? I just can't believe how steep it is.
Unreal, the elevation is just incredible.
Track discussions continued with thoughts about race lines, if they managed to get their car and equipment to the track. And eventually the team's first ever view and circulation of the famous mountain came to an end, which meant now they could leave and visit the town of Bathurst, find their home base for the week, and get on with other serious matters, which basically meant more time talking, socialising, and sorting out who would be doing what job on the car.
Race today, weekend, good win.
Yeah.
Oh, great. Stoked. Oh.
That's a little.
Wednesday morning, 48 hours till first practice. Yeah. And still no word on when the car, spares, and tools would arrive. This gave the team time to sort the paperwork and confirm things like which garage they would be in, how the fuel supply would work, what the plan would be once the car eventually turned up, what was on Facebook for that morning, and then of course, more discussion on the whole upcoming procedure. But whilst they got to spend time watching other teams prepare, some small miracles started to appear, like the spare rims via the team's link with Maranello Motorsport, so they could at least go about the business of organising rubber. And they eventually found where the fuel supply was located and how all that would work. At least it gave them something to do.
What about bring a truck? What do they normally, we bring it to you?
Okay, it's
fantastic. Which car?
Ferrari.
Yep.
Yeah. It's still on the boat, mate.
Okay.
We've got a problem. It's not going to be here till probably tomorrow night.
Late. Okay.
So
right.
We've got a big job. That's why we're just sort of trying to suss a few just things out.
Come and have a look.
Because it's going to become a nightmare.
Yeah. That's right. Well, we're full service, so you don't need to worry about fuel. Yeah. We do it for you.
I do.
But you will need a drum pump.
Yep.
And while tyres and fuel may have been organised, it was still a waiting game, while others continued to arrive around them. Thursday morning, and with practice number one only 24 hours away, news had come through that the car was off the boat and would arrive sometime during that time frame. Meanwhile, the team could focus all their attention on trying to stay busy by tyre stacking, tyre sorting, and tyre sitting. Anything to try and mentally stay on their game whilst all around them, plans were well underway. Mid-afternoon, news had filtered through that the container would definitely arrive sometime before midnight, and that meant a change of gear, with team manager Richard Lester needing to ensure that the plan of attack was as smooth as possible.
Well, what we need over here initially is we need a car. The car's going to be parked up. And we need gradually all the tools and stuff, the trolleys with the tools, all that important stuff come out. And very quickly we'll tie some nitrogen bolts and threes so the boys can get the car up and actually get going.
Then, as the day slowly started to turn into night and other teams were well into their preparations, word was in. A truck with a container full of equipment and a race car was close. Things were about to get busy.
Finally the bloody car's here. Look, what is it? It's close to 9 o'clock on Thursday. Been here for 2.5 days and finally here. So boys are all kitted out in new gear and ready for a huge night. Huge night, getting the car prepped, getting our pits set up. And everything done that we were supposed to be doing the last 2.5 days as we watch the container just around the corner right as we speak. So it's exciting times.
Attack now is we'll get this thing on the ground, open her up. We've already organised how it's going to happen as far as getting all the gear out. Ferrari out first, all the tools and equipment to get working on it out ASAP. All the rest of it we'll bring out carefully bit by bit. We'll set up the pit walls and start making our pit garage into a home while our select group of guys get to work on the car. So we're going to smash it out now until 1:30, 2 o'clock.
Feel the team spirit lifting minute by minute as the container arrives and is about to be unloaded. TFM's about to hit the big time. This feels good.
With less than 12 hours remaining until the practice sessions would get underway, the Trass Family Motorsport team had a mammoth task ahead of them. Firstly, they had to find everything and check it all for damage due to the rather casual care factor shown by the customs inspection team after they had emptied and repacked the container at the ports. The car was still to have some parts fitted and modifications done to it so that it would pass scrutineering, of which they were given a time dispensation on due to already missing the cutoff. The three drivers had not even done any seat fitments. Nothing about this challenge was coming easy.
Right, 2 hours in, what you can see behind is what we've done in that time. Out the back further, we've got all the living area and all the sort of technical working area all being built as well. Boys are hard into it with the car, done amazing work in a small period of time. 2 days of sitting around doing nothing and they fired up like we're smoking.
So while other teams were heading off for the comfort of their beds and the entire pit row had closed up shop, Trass Family Motorsport would continue on into the wee hours of Friday morning, because no late car was going to bring this Kiwi team down.
Anchor down.
Down.
Closed.
With only a couple of hours sleep behind them, the Kiwis were back at it before dawn, and there was still plenty to be done. And whether it was a minor job or a major one, there was only one end goal: to see the car out on the track for the first practice.
So we've walked in this morning, look what these boys have done, fantastic. They worked through the night, right through till about 3:30 in the morning, I believe, while us drivers were at home sleeping. So fantastic effort by them. Obviously, you know, these boys are working their butts off and they will do all we can. And to set up what they've done in a matter of hours and now have the car pretty much track ready with an hour before we hit the track is just awesome. So John and I are about to get ready for the first session. I believe we'll be completing that, and it'll be my first look at this fantastic Bathurst circuit. So bring it on.
After 2 days of frustration and a night of solid work, things were about to get real. The team representing Trass Family Motorsport was about to put the Ferrari onto the Bathurst circuit.
Pretty excited. It's all sort of finally happening here. The car arrived last night. Boys worked pretty much all night on it. We arrived this morning and we're just finishing up a few things now.
And whilst both Lester and Smythe were in no doubt chafing at the bit to get behind the wheel and experience the mountain, first honours would go to the experienced John McIntyre.
Like we'd expect this morning. Let's just shut it down now. Take a big deep breath, slow down. No more running. No more running at all. Just slow it right down. Think about what we're doing, right? Wait for the call from either Carl or myself, right? But let's just get into the session through and then everybody just take a step back, take a deep breath, and just move on nice and smoothly, right?
Well, we've finally made it. It's our first practice. Feel like a dad whose kid's just been born. And coming out into the world, it's an awesome feeling. Beautiful day here on the track. So many incredible cars. Team's looking really good. I feel really good about this weekend.
So once McIntyre had taken the edge off the nerves of the entire team, it would be the turn of Jono Lester, sliding in to fulfil a dream of piloting a Ferrari around the famed Mount Panorama.
Amazing how light the car gets.
I know. I forgot to tell you that. Like, it tracks. It's tracking a lot, right?
Up mountain straight.
Yeah. Hey, I know. I told Graham. I forgot to tell you. That's right. I was quite surprised. And it tracks every camber on the road, doesn't it?
Mm.
Later in the day, Graham Smythe would have his first turn on the mountain. But for now, in between the official practice sessions, the team could slip into the normal mode of a race weekend, which was a combination of the normal car checks, parts to be cleaned, car data to be analysed, and more equipment to be prepped. And while that was going on, Jono Lester could take some time to dwell on the occasion that just happened.
Pretty bloody cool. I feel like a laboratory dog at the top, don't know what I'm doing. But it's good. It's really good. I'm just trying to process how to get my head around the top section around the hill. As I said to someone just 5 minutes ago, the bottom half's a piece of piss. The top, so we'll see what happens in practice too.
Word had spread quickly throughout the field and the media contingent about how a team whose experience on the mountain was pretty much only that of driver John McIntyre was fighting and punching well above their weight, because despite their initial setbacks and the ridiculous time frame to get ready, the crew had given the drivers a car that was circulating inside the top 10. All eyes were now on Trass Family Motorsport. Then it was practice two, where Graham Smythe would finally get his first crack at the hill.
This place is unbelievable. It doesn't matter where you are on the track, it's just like nothing else I've ever driven ever. It's absolutely insane. You're going up the top and there's just absolutely no room for error. You make a slight mistake and you'll be in a wall. You're turning in over brows, the car's completely light. It's insane. I don't know, it's just crazy. To be able to jump out of my first session without making any mistakes, I'm pretty happy. It's just a matter of easing into it, and yeah, hopefully come Sunday we'll all be comfortable and be on the pace.
So you just skimmed across the wall?
Huh?
Yeah, touched the wall.
I'm pretty sure I did.
There was a mark.
Maybe that, but as I came through the step at Bentley, and I stood on it, and I think it might have just gone bang. Like really minor.
Yes.
And then it's just got a vibration.
Just a small vibration, not under braking or anything?
Well, it's through the
just
wheel.
Just constant
it's
vibration.
Through the wheel, yeah.
So, practice two. Had a chance to think about things, think about my psyche, how I approach this thing. Graham started, did a fantastic job, put us in the top 10, and obviously having had a chance for the last couple of hours to think about my approach up the top, went straight back out, it was like a different car. Balance is great, and we put the car up in P4, I think we dropped to P6 at the end, but we're right there. Bloody awesome.
From there, the day would almost become normal. Drivers would continue to circulate and gain as much track time as possible to finish with the in-depth discussions and analysis of those drives. Ferrari specialists direct from Italy could offer their advice and pitch in to get their hands dirty. the crew could get to work on the small things like the refueling bay, and drivers could finally get their custom seat spaces, with the crew generally working away to spend their Friday night prepping a race car. Saturday morning, after a very long 36 hours, one final practice session was to be held before the all-important qualifying run. It would serve as a clear chance for everyone to settle their nerves, for both the crew and the drivers. It would also offer the opportunity for some final feedback on the car's handling, along with any last-minute setup changes, and of course, it would be the last time they would have to iron out any small creases or find any hidden issues. Because after all their hard work, the last thing this team needed was more of those.
Just analysing to see whether it is an issue that's going to become a big issue or whether it's not.
I saw a blue light on the dash, and it was a little bit disconcerting when I was out there, so I backed off for a lap, called into the pits and actually came in. Boys downloaded the computer, the ECU, and the boys from Michelotto decided that it was best to bring the car in and have a proper look at it. For precautionary sake, if we do have a genuine oil pressure problem and it's not an electronic thing, then heaven forbid we stay out there and keep running around potentially damaging the engine. So we've got time, we've got a couple of hours before qualifying, so it's nothing to stress out about majorly. We've got guys here from Italy that know exactly what they're doing.
This is the issue. This is the pipe that is gathering the oil.
When do we have to make qualifying?
Well, we don't have to make qualifying, but we have to make the race.
Yeah.
There's an oil tube broken inside the gearbox and it's causing a suction problem for the oil. Don't know how long it's going to take. I haven't done it before, so see how we go. All hands on deck.
So with less than 2 hours till qualifying would begin, the crew, with advice from the Italians, would find, remove and replace the problem part. And it was becoming apparent very quickly that this team thrived when it came to working under pressure.
Okay, the shaft, you have to make sure the shaft gets inside.
Once you snap off, there's a filter over top of it.
Yep.
We're just finishing up now. Replace the broken pipe, as you saw. So just putting it back together, getting the oil back in, replaced with a new oil filter, and then we'll be out for qualifying. So good find, and straight back into it.
You may notice the high precision funnel here.
The team had done it, and by completing it so efficiently, it actually gave them a chance to have a go at a paced tyre change, because that, along with the refueling, had still to be practiced for the very first time. And it was something that would have to wait, because qualifying was about to begin.
So there's two qualifying sessions. First session's an hour, giving all three drivers a quick run. For Jono and Graham, it's just a few extra miles. Then what happens is we have a 10-minute parc fermé where we're allowed to change tyres, and we've got a very short 20-minute one driver, sort of like a bit of a shootout. We're going to put John in the car for that on a set of green medium tyres, and just that, and hopefully, depending on the heat, that should decide the final grid position.
Thank you.
just had an outlap during qualifying. The Mark Mazda, whatever it is, tried to take a Class A breakpoint up the top and ended up in the wall just in front of me. So we sort of knew there was going to be a red flag, so we calmed it down, and we will start our run proper in this next run here rather than ruin the tyres. So it's quite hot out here now. Apparently the car's got a little bit of oversteer, as Graham was saying. So we just need to monitor that, but I think we've still got a really good race car, so we'll bank some laps and then get John in to do his familiarisation before the second qualifying and see where we are on the grid.
Welcome to Bathurst.
A period of 40 hours with virtually no sleep, Trass Family Motorsport had, in a way, overachieved. Their crew had done their initial part to give John McIntyre a car that he would qualify a solid 16th in. And with 50 machines in the field, it was a stellar effort by all. However, the final preparation work would continue well into the night, because even amongst all the fun and games that this team brought to the event, there was still a serious 12 hours of Bathurst to deal with. Although this lot couldn't help themselves by getting into the zone a little earlier than the rest.
With the car being worked on the whole time, we haven't had much time to do too much. So, quick practice and into it, Kiwi style.
I'm pretty calm. I'm in the car third, I think. John's going to start, then I think Jono's going to jump in. So it'll be a couple of hours before I'm in. So yeah, nerves are pretty good at the moment. I'm not starting, so that's going to it's put a weight off my shoulders. But yeah, it's pretty happening pace right now. So we're just running through some driver changes. We didn't manage to get it done last night. We sort of ran out of time.
It's finally happened. Amazing elation. Sense of joy, relief, excitement. We're in for one hell of a journey today, and no one knows where it's going to go yet, but man, it's going to be fun.
It's pitch black, haven't done this before, and yeah, we're just finally here. I can't believe that the week's gone by so quick, even with our delays. It seems like it's flown by. So starting P16, obviously a little bit further back than we've been testing, but you know, we're working to a plan, and I still think we've got a podium shot today. So I'm so pumped. Bugger all sleep, but still for some reason full of energy. I wonder why.
So finally, the car was on the grid, and race proper would begin. And just like every other team, it would now be a waiting game. The true test of the team had now begun. as expected by many, a safety car was dispatched early on in the event. And whilst that spelled trouble for one or two teams, for Tras Family Motorsport, it was a continuation of the same, staying calm and generally just enjoying themselves, because soon it would be time for the first pit stop, when the games cease and business begins. The initial test would be how well they handled their first pit stop, having only had a couple of mock goes at it. Not only did they need to complete their tasks cleanly, they had to make sure that the little rules were not broken, such as how many team members are allowed across the line at one time. First pit stop, a pass mark for Tras Family Motorsport.
It's worth starting to go slightly in the rear, but I think that's mainly our car balance.
Tell them I'm going to the cryo thing.
Well, just what an unbelievable start, an unreal race. I mean, we started in a lot darker than we thought. Like, it was really hard over the top. A lot of guys with 24-hour lights that we didn't have. And just trying to judge the walls, and we were in a pack for a long time doing really slow laps. Then it all spread out, and next thing you know, we've got an early safety car, and someone gets hit by a kangaroo. We missed a kangaroo by that much down Conrod Street doing about 250 Ks. So pure luck. He just kept on going. He didn't stop and have a look at the car, because if he did, he would have been in with me. It would have been all over. So, but the car's great. It just, yeah, really good first stint. Really happy with that. Lots of moments with other cars and things, but we survived it, and we got 8, 9, 12, 10 more, lots more to go, so yeah, report back later.
Must be getting close. You probably can see a fuel kilo read on the dash, but it won't be far behind.
They just made a little report about the rear diffuser. They flipped it around a little bit. We need to keep it on. It's not a problem at the moment, but it could be a problem. So let's have a think about it. If it is a problem, how would we quickly fix it to hold it together? Just have to give it a bit of thought. So maybe cable ties and a drill might need to be ready just in case. Something along those lines.
Nearly one quarter of the race had now gone by, and the number 27 had stayed away from trouble. But little things can quickly turn into big things, so the call was made to bring Jono in, top up the fuel, and have a look at a potential problem. With that out of the way, it was soon to be the turn for Smythe to keep the Ferrari circulating inside the top 10. We'll be right back.
3 hours, so that's our fourth safety car. We had over 30 minutes, nearly 40 minutes or so between Jono and John safety car, so that's why we've left the medium tyre on for another stint. And we'll run Graham through after 45 minutes or so. If we do get another safety car, we'll probably come in and get Graham out and fire on a set of hards, which we'll run through on the rest of the day. We'll be running hards. Otherwise, if there's no safety car, we'll just wait until we run out, until we get to low on fuel. So we'll play the strategy game in between.
We're trying to play the game, really, and catch the safety cars at the right time. That can often backfire on you, but so far that's worked perfectly for us. We took an early stop with Jono for fuel, and we've managed to catch that up with a couple of safety cars. And now with Graham in the car, we've just fueled up again, and a couple of laps later there's a safety car. So we were a minute and 50 behind the lead at that time, and now we're right back up on the train. So working nicely at the moment, but they can also go against you.
Jumped in the car, second stint. John did a fantastic first stint, got us up to 8th spot. I went out, we had a couple of safety cars which sort of made it quite a cruisy start to the stint, and once it got going we went through the entire oxygen tank of fuel. I was cautious but pushing, but it looks like we were really good in traffic, so to pit from second place I couldn't believe it. I thought we were 5th or 6th or 7th, so I mean, you know, it's obviously early days, but it's going really good at the moment.
Eventually, the team would have their first full deal pit stop. Driver, drink, fuel and tyres. And whilst it was not Formula One pace, it was completed trouble-free in a minute and 15 seconds, with only a couple of blokes rather than 20. Cycle would continue on. Team fun, keeping busy. More team fun, with the occasional driver swap and the topping up of fuel. It was all fairly routine, but as everyone who follows motorsport knows, even the tiniest of little problems can cause quite the setback. Soon, the team would be a lap down.
Graham's just come in. He felt it was a bit unsettled going over the hill. Originally he thought he had damaged some suspension in the right rear. It turns out it was just a puncture. So we got him to come into the garage, checked everything, everything's fine, puncture, and then straight back out.
Graham's just come in. He had an issue with the seat where it was clicking. With the safety car, we had an opportunity to just rectify that, so we just clicked it into pace. He's doing a really good job at the moment. He was in a battle pack and he's running just as quick as the front guys in the pack, which has been really impressive. That's exactly what we need at this stage in the race. And I think if we carry on like this and get on the lead lap, we're up for a good result.
Mm-hmm.
so far, we've had an interesting run. We've managed to stay on the lead lap for most of the first 6 hours. Unfortunately, we had Graham get crook, and we had to get him out of the car for 47 minutes and get him down to medical so we could get hydrated up and fixed up. We got him back in the car, and unfortunately we got a puncture within just a couple of laps, so that was a green flag stop we didn't want, and that's put us a lap down. So we're hovering, we'll just, we're still reasonably strong for later, we'll just see how things pan out, but losing that lap wasn't ideal, and without that puncture we wouldn't have lost the lap.
So the first half of the race was reasonably smooth, but that was about to change. Scary news had come through. A wheel was missing from the Ferrari. A very nervous team now had to plan for the unknown and the possibility of remaining in the race.
Graham's come into the last corner after a safety car restart and hit the brake, and all we know is that something's broken. He hasn't hit anything, I don't believe, but he's stuck and he's past pit entry, so he can't exactly drive backwards up the track to get in. The only way back is to do an entire lap, I believe, on three wheels. So I don't know whether the truck will be kind enough to duck him over the grass, but yeah, it happens.
There is a possibility we can bring it straight through. So we'll just get some Allen keys and just unbolt that. Just move that out of the way.
Knock out. 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 Knock unusual, let us know. Thank you.
Wheel fell off, came in on the tow truck. The boys shot down there, took it out of Parc Fermé, brought it down to the pits, chucked a new disc on it. All the dowels were okay, banged a new set of rubber all round, and went out. Jono's in the car now, so see how we go.
Do is bring you in, top you off with fuel, do the oil in the engine, and then do your water and send you.
Oil temperature's at 130. And we're going to chuck oil in now, and we've cleaned the...
What's
Harmon doing?
He's doing oil.
The oil, okay, with...
Can you do it by yourself?
Do it by yourself.
So what are you doing?
I need to clean the radiators and I need to check the oil cooler and blow from around the front of the car.
Okay.
And I will wait and do the oil.
Right. Let Harry do the water. He's out of water. Let Harry do the water. And then they can go straight out and do their thing. Then Harry go out and do the water. As soon as Harry comes back, you go out and start that
I'll
process.
I'll need a hand to get the socket off. That's all. You want to give me a hand because the socket jams.
Left in the race kept reducing, Trace Family Motorsport had succumbed to the fact that the potential podium shown by the speed and position from practice, qualifying and the morning segment of the race was well and truly out of reach. But not wanting to quit, the team were doing whatever they could to keep the Ferrari out on the circuit. Overheating from inside the engine bay was slowly starting to become a way bigger issue than simply cleaning the radiators.
Obviously we're down and out, so you know, we may as well go out and have a good time out on the track. I mean, hopefully we're only here once, but this is our first time, and you know, it's going to be a year before we're back here at Bathurst, so... That was awesome. It's 2 hours stint, and we're battling with the pole sitter, we're battling with the Largo Lamborghini, battling with the factory Bentleys. I mean, all the guys that are sitting in the top three or four. So we've got genuine pace. We just have 13 laps in the hole, unfortunately. So I mean, we've got to look at the positives, and nobody in the team has messed up. You know, it's been a fault that there's nobody's, you know, human error. So. Can't be overly critical of ourselves. Spending the weekend so far.
Sadly, the current run by John McIntyre would be the last. During the full pit stop, which would also include putting Smythe back into the driver's seat, the number 27 had enough. The team's only real consolation at this point in time was from the fact that they caught the problem before sending Graham back out. The valiant charge at the Bathurst 12-hour for this beast and its crew was over.
Take a breath, go and get a drink, and we'll come back to it in 5 minutes or so.
Just watching Bentley lead this race, the same Bentley that we were battling with for a good portion of the race. We really deserve to be out there today. You know, we've had an awesome run. The team have been faultless. Everybody's done their part, and I guess we'd be a bit more disappointed to withdraw the car like we're doing now if we had been running at the front with an hour to go, you know, which is what it is right now. You know, we obviously knew that we were down and the chips were against us, but it doesn't make it any less disappointing because I think we all know that we could have achieved something great here today, but I guess... which means we've got to come back next year, and we will be back next year in some capacity. I'll be back next year in some capacity, and I'm sure the Trask Family Motorsport team will as well, and you know, I'd love to be a part of it. So we've got an AGT Championship to win now. It's been a great build-up. I think we can do it. I really do. Iron out these little issues. You know, we've had awesome help from Italy with Ferrari this weekend, and they've taught us a lot about the car, a lot of things that are going to, I guess, reduce the risk of having little issues this season. So I'm happy. I'm actually happy. I'm happy with the overall picture. I'm just disappointed with the result. I think ongoing it's really good.
The result and how it all ended is absolutely no reflection of the effort this weekend. I think that's why I'm so gutted, everyone's so dejected, because we were a genuine top 10 chance, and I don't mean just around the edge of the 10. We're, you know, in maybe the top 6 all day. So look, it's a tough place to come, first time out for this team, so they've done a brilliant job. Thanks to Gerald, thanks to everyone in the team, all our sponsors, all my sponsors. Love to be back again next year, so yeah, thanks for the support, everyone. Appreciate it.
Where do I start? Today just wasn't our day. It started off really good with John and Jono having a good first in each. I jumped in and I probably only did half an hour and then started feeling really ill. Jumped out, went to the medical centre, got all checked and had something to eat and drink. Jumped in again after that and did about a 2 hour stint. Felt really good, car was all good. And then we had a wheel fall. We had a flat tyre to begin with, came in, sorted that, went back out. I think we were running in about 7th and then we had a wheel come off. So that sort of was where the day really started to go downhill. Everything other than that was really good. I think if we didn't have any problems, we would have been in for an easy top 10. I'm pretty comfortable to say that, but yeah, I guess it's just what might have been.
We've been on a real journey here at the moment, feeling a bit disappointed but also quite happy and satisfied that we came here. We gave it our best shot, we performed really well, we got a bit unlucky with the car, and as they say, that's motor racing. I now feel that you know, it's good enough to give it another shot and come back stronger and better next time. So it's all good.
Well, we got really close, 11 hours in, and just turned to custard really. Big effort from everybody involved, especially the crew with us arriving late. We were behind the eight ball all the way. We were trying all the way until this morning of the race to actually finish the little jobs that we were planning to do on the 2 days we didn't have the car while I was sitting on the boat bobbing in the ocean. Had that wheel issue, which is really quite perturbing, especially the wheel had been off for 2 hours.
and she's overheated. And I think possibly some of the overheating has occurred when we've been doing these too many of these pit stops to fix the little issues. And once it gets to a certain point, it's very hard to bring it back down. So rather than damage the engine, save it. We've got Australian GT in 3 weeks. We want to make sure we're there strong.